Now, if you notice carefully, an interesting phenomena is there that when the pH goes on the higher side, when the pH moves more than 7.45, we call it alkalosis. And when the bicarbonate is more than 26, we call it metabolic alkalosis. So they behave in the same way. When pH is more than 7.45, this is known as alkalosis, and when bicarbonate is more than 26 milliequivalent per liter, it is called metabolic alkalosis. When pH is less than 7.35, this is known as acidosis, and when the bicarbonate is less than 22, this is known as metabolic acidosis. So the value of the pH and the value of the bicarbonate, they behave in the same manner. When they go higher than their normal range, they both are called alkalosis, and when both of these are less than the normal limit, these are then known as acidosis. But in contrary to that, PCO2 is behaving in opposite direction. How? When the PCO2 is more than 45, is more than its upper normal limit, it is called respiratory acidosis. But in case of the pH, we have seen when the pH is more than its upper normal limit, it will be called as alkalosis, not the acidosis. And when the PCO2 is less than 35, this is known as respiratory alkalosis. But in case of the pH, when the pH was less than its lower normal limit, it is called acidosis. So the behavior of the carbon dioxide and behavior of the bicarbonate in a relation with the pH is opposite. Bicarbonate behavior is as the behavior of the pH, and the PCO2 behavior is in the opposite direction. In order to remember this interesting phenomena, there is a mnemonic which we call ROME, R-O-M-E, R-O-M-E, ROME. ROME is the capital city of Italy, but here it represents one very important phrase: respiratory opposite, metabolic equal. In relation with the pH, respiratory behavior is opposite, and metabolic or the bicarbonate behavior is equal to the pH. How? pH decreases, we call it acidosis. Bicarbonate decreases, we call it acidosis. pH increases, we call it alkalosis. Bicarbonate increases, we call it alkalosis. So they behave equally. But in terms of the partial pressure of carbon dioxide, when the PaCO2 is less than 35, we call it alkalosis. But pH, when it went less than the 7.35, we call it acidosis. So its behavior is opposite to the pH. When the PCO2 goes more than 45, which is its normal upper limit, we call it respiratory acidosis. But when the pH went more than 7.45, we called it alkalosis. So respiratory behavior is opposite and metabolic behavior is equal in relation with the pH. So in order to remember this interesting phenomena, you need to remember this mnemonic of ROME, ROME, respiratory opposite and metabolic equal. So if we want to understand the behavior of partial pressure of carbon dioxide and bicarbonate concentration in relation with the pH, we should also remember a very important equation which we call Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. What is this equation? Henderson-Hasselbalch equation is pH is equal to pKa plus log 10 bicarbonate over PaCO2. That means this is known as Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Though it shows the relation of the pH with the alkaline and the acidic component of the ABGs. pH is equal to pKa plus log 10 into bicarbonate over PaCO2. It also reflects this phenomena that pH is directly affected with the bicarbonate and inversely affected by the partial pressure of carbon dioxide. If the bicarbonate goes high, pH goes high. If the PCO2 go high, pH comes down. If the bicarbonate goes low, pH goes low. But when the PCO2 goes low, pH should go high. And this is what's written over there. When the pH is more, it is alkalosis. When the bicarbonate is more, it's alkalosis. But when PCO2 is more, it is acidosis. Likewise, when the pH is less than 7.35, it is acidosis. When the bicarbonate is less than 22, it's acidosis. But when the PaCO2 is less, it is alkalosis. So the behavior is also explained in the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation, which is pH is equal to pKa plus log 10 into bicarbonate over acid or PaCO2. We can also write it this way. pH, we can also simplify the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation like this. pH bicarbonate over PaCO2. This will help us to understand this concept of the relationship between the bicarbonate and the partial pressure of carbon dioxide. That partial pressure of carbon dioxide is inversely affecting the pH, while the bicarbonate is directly affecting the pH. But always remember that hydrogen ion, pH is inverse log of hydrogen ion. So bicarbonate and PaCO2 are affecting the inverse log of the hydrogen ion, which we call the pH. Bicarbonate directly affects it and PaCO2 inversely affects it. So when the PaCO2 goes high, pH goes low, but the pH is inverse log of hydrogen ion. So when the PCO2 goes high, acid goes high, because inverse log of hydrogen ion is pH, so its inverse is hydrogen ion. When the PCO2 go high, though it decreases the pH, but it will increase the hydrogen ion. But when the bicarbonate will increase in the body, it will increase the pH, but will decrease the hydrogen ion in the body, and this is what we call alkaline state. So this is a Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Now, after having a little bit idea about it, let's try to understand what's the clinical role of the ABGs in our lives. But before that, let's talk a little bit about another component, which is partial pressure of oxygen. Partial pressure of oxygen is normally 60 to 100 millimeter of mercury. Partial pressure of oxygen is 60 to 100 millimeter of mercury. Carbon dioxide was produced in the body as a result of metabolism. But in order to carry that metabolism or the combustion process in our body, or aerobic oxidation, we need oxygen from the environment. We take the oxygen from the environment. In the environment, there is 21% oxygen and rest is the nitrogen. And this is what we call FiO2, fraction of inspired oxygen. It is 21%. in the environment. From the environment, we take it down to the lungs, all the way up to the tissues. Again, if I make this trachea, this is right bronchus, which is straight, and this is the left bronchus, which takes a turn. This takes an acute turn, so aspiration mostly comes here. So here then comes the bronchioles, then primary, secondary, tertiary, and ultimately respiratory and terminal bronchioles, and then there are alveoli, and these are blood vessels which are carrying. Here it's deoxygenated blood. So oxygen comes from the environment, goes through the trachea, then to the bronchioles, then to the these are the bronchi, then the bronchioles, then the primary, secondary, tertiary, and respiratory and terminal bronchioles, and then through the alveoli it enters into the blood. So the venous blood has got less oxygen, but arterial blood has got high oxygen, because this oxygen is coming from the alveoli. So partial pressure of the oxygen, when it goes less than 60 millimeter of mercury, in spite of giving additional oxygen, when it goes less than 60 millimeter of mercury, we call it type 1 respiratory failure. Type 1 respiratory failure. So another very important use of ABGs, is to diagnose type 1 respiratory failure. The definition of the type 1 respiratory failure is, when the partial pressure of oxygen in the body, in the blood of the ABGs, goes less than 60 millimeter of mercury in spite of giving additional oxygen, we call it type 1 respiratory failure. And why it happens? Because sometime these alveoli, if I make one alveolus here, these alveoli, this is the blood vessel going, this is venule, this is arteriole, blood is flowing this way, and this is these are the capillaries. So oxygen comes from here, enters, diffuses through the interstitium between the alveolus and the capillary, and enters the blood and goes to the artery. But sometime, because of the infection, there becomes a proteinaceous material which obstruct the entry of the oxygen through the alveolus to the capillaries. This is what we call pneumonia. So pneumonia is one good example of the type 1 respiratory failure. So through the ABGs we can know about the type 1 respiratory failure. When the partial pressure of oxygen goes less than 60 millimeter of mercury in spite of giving additional oxygen. One good example is a proteinaceous material present inside the alveolus. This is what we call the pneumonia. There can be bacteria, there can be WBC, there can be some macrophages. So it all clumps there and it obstructs the path of the oxygen from the alveolus to the interstitium. But sometime what happens, that there may be some blood fluid present between the in the interstitium between the alveolus and the capillary. Here there may be some fluid. It may be because of a higher pressure in the capillaries as a result of heart failure. This is what we call pulmonary edema. So one example of the type 1 respiratory failure was pneumonia. Second example is pulmonary edema in case of left ventricular failure or kidney failure, that causes the hydrostatic pressure to go high. So fluid from the capillaries enters into this interstitium and again obstructs the entry of the oxygen from the alveolus to the capillaries. This is known as pulmonary edema. Now another example is when there is a proteinaceous material instead of the fluid, there is accumulation of the proteinaceous material in the interstitium between the alveolus and the capillaries. This is what we call ARDS. acute respiratory distress syndrome or adult respiratory distress syndrome are very famously known as acute respiratory distress syndrome. So these are the three very famous examples of the type 1 respiratory failure, where there is a difficulty in the passage of the oxygen from the environment through the trachea, then the bronchi, then the bronchioles, then the primary secondary tertiary bronchiole and respiratory and terminal, then comes the alveoli. This is one alveolus. Here there is a proteinaceous material between in the interstitium between the alveolus and the capillaries. So oxygen cannot enter from here to the blood. So these are examples of the type 1 respiratory failure. Now, what is the definition of type 2 respiratory failure? Type 2 respiratory failure is when the partial pressure of carbon dioxide is more than 60 millimeter of mercury. Type 2 respiratory failure is when the partial pressure of carbon dioxide, arterial carbon dioxide, is more than 60 millimeter of mercury, we call it type 2 respiratory failure. Because we already discussed that though the oxygen is provided from the environment to the body tissues, but in the body tissues as a result of the metabolism, there is production of the carbon dioxide which needs to be removed from the body through the lungs. What is the process of its removal? This is trachea. It bifurcates at carina into right, which is direct, has an acute angle, but left it takes a turn, steep turn. So whenever patient aspirates gastric contents, they are mostly going towards the right lung, because the trachea and right bronchus, they are sort of in line with each other. Then it divides into bronchioles divide into primary, secondary and tertiary, and ultimately respiratory bronchiole, which have got alveoli. Now what happens that these bronchioles, they are mainly involved, bronchi and the bronchioles, they are mainly involved in removing the carbon dioxide from the body to the outside environment. And whenever there is some obstruction of these bronchi or the bronchioles, which we call bronchoconstriction bronchi. These are bronchi and these are bronchioles. Whenever there is bronchoconstriction, then there is a difficulty in removing the carbon dioxide from the body to the outside environment. So this carbon dioxide increases within the body, and when we get the arterial blood gases, the partial pressure of the arterial carbon dioxide is more than 60 millimeter of the mercury, we call it type 2 respiratory failure. The two main examples of the bronchoconstrictive or the constrictive lung diseases, the obstructive lung diseases, are asthma and COPD. Chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, which comprises of chronic bronchitis and emphysema. So these are two categories of the famous obstructive lung diseases, which cause the partial pressure of oxygen to go higher than 60 millimeter of the mercury. When it happens, so we call it the type 2 respiratory failure. But there are some other diseases like the Guillain-Barré syndrome and myasthenia gravis, where because of the fatigue of the respiratory muscle or weakness of the respiratory muscle, patient is not able to exhale properly. When patient is not able to exhale properly, see, carbon dioxide starts retaining within the body, and when the pressure goes more than 60 millimeter of the mercury, we call it the type 2 respiratory failure. And patient in these situations starts becoming drowsy or unconscious because of CO2 narcosis, because carbon dioxide crosses blood-brain barrier and it makes a patient sleepy. So most of these patients, they present to us with sleepy state and meotic pupils. Their pupils are constricted. If the normal size of the pupil is 2.5 millimeter, it will be around 1 millimeter. Most of the patients, sometimes we receive in the emergency departments and the ICUs, they are addicts, like they are opioid, they have taken heroin or methadone or these kind of opioids, and they cause the respiratory depression because of CO2 narcosis, because their respiratory depression, the center in the medulla, they are depressed, they are not able to remove the carbon dioxide, which very rapidly crosses the blood-brain barrier and causes the decrease in the conscious level of the patient. So another very important use of the arterial blood gases is to diagnose type 1 and type 2 respiratory failures, and through type 1 and type 2 we can reach whether there is pneumonia, there is ARDS, there is pulmonary edema, or if there is type 2 respiratory failure, we can look for the bronchoconstrictive or obstructive lung disease like asthma and COPD. COPD is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, which has two components, chronic bronchitis and emphysema.